All right, welcome everybody to the Algebra 2 Chapter 2 review. This is the 2018 edition of this video. If you're watching the older versions, we have changed some of our content. There was a section basically that fit better in another chapter, so we did move some things around. Nice thing is it makes our work a little bit easier. There's less for us to worry about. Let's get to this. I apologize in advance if this video is moving kind of quickly. My thought process is just to review this as quickly as possible for you. So if you have to pause the video or something like that, I'm sorry for the inconvenience, but I just want it to be as efficient as possible. I'm working on a little bit of a limited time frame here. So let's get to it. All right, so the first task is to describe transformations of some parent quadratic function and then graph the function itself. So for problem number one, here I've got, and I prefer if you write it like this on your test, kind of make a little diagram here, pointing to the negative 7, that is a shift to the right 7 units and a shift up 2. Remember, if the change is applied inside with the input, in with x, then it's left or right. If it's outside, then it's affecting the graph up and down. Those shifts move our vertex 7 units to the right and up 2 units. And from there, the parabola opens upward following our, from the vertex, 1, 1, and 2, 4. So we can plot those points and mirror them. Oh, I'm sorry, the smart board's glitching a little bit right there at that point. But that's what our graph should look like. We can do that very, very quickly. For problem number two, we've got a couple more things involved. First, the negative sign out front represents a vertical flip. Okay, that's casual language we're using in this class. You could say like a reflection over the x-axis. We also say 3 times as tall for that 3 that's multiplied out front, or a vertical stretch by 3. Plus 2 inside, that means a shift to the left 2. And minus 1 outside is a shift down 1. Let's apply our shifts first. That will lead us to the vertex, left 2 and down 1. Now my parabola is going to open downwards, and it's going to be a 3 times the height at each of those points. So from my vertex, instead of going over 1, down 1, I'm going to go over 1, down 3 and mirror that point. Over 2 and down 12, that'll be way down here. So we get a very tall, skinny, downward-facing parabola for those. These should be very quick. They're meant to be, how efficiently can we graph using our transformations? Okay, from there. Problem number 3. Here we have to construct a function from some given transformations. All right, and we notice that, we're not starting with the parent function. We're starting with this. And I don't see the words followed by in the problem, so there's not an order for me to follow here. So G is a horizontal shrink and a reflection in the x-axis. So that means a reflection in the x is a vertical flip, so a negative out front of the function. And then 1/4 means that graph is going 4 times as fast. So it's a 4x inside to cause that horizontal shrink. Remember horizontals, we said that was like bizarro world kind of happening there. So let's see what this looks like. A negative sign is applying to everything in function f. And wherever I see an input that's x up here, I'm going to replace that with 4x. So it's 4x squared minus 2 times 4x. And we can clean that up a little bit. This is what I really, really want to see. That shows me that you're applying the negatives and the numbers in the correct places. But if we wanted to clean that up a little bit, we could. So it's negative 16x squared, square the 4, square the x, minus 8x. Or we distribute the negative as well, negative 16x squared plus 8x without that quantity. Again, cannot stress enough, this is what I want to see somewhere. After that, the simplification, I don't think it shows the transformations as much as well. But you have the option to do that. All right, so next, translation, 5 units left and 2 units up, then I see followed by. So this first step, I'm going to call that H. I can't call it G because that's my final answer. To go 5 units left and 2 units up, 5 units left means I subtract 5 from my input. Sorry, add 5 to my input. And then 2 units up means I add 2 afterwards. So H of X is this x minus 3 quantity squared. So instead of x, I'm going to have x plus 5 minus 3 squared. Then the minus 1, that's still a part of f, what I started with, but we added 2 at the end. We can combine like terms, clean this up, x plus 2 squared plus 1. Combining like terms is a simplifying step that we should do. It's a little bit different. I hope we can see the difference between the one up above. All right, we're ready for our final part. Our final answer, G, followed by a vertical shrink by a factor of 3/4. So that means I take 3/4, multiply it outside the function that I just created, the one that included step one. So G of x is going to take 3/4 times x plus 2 quantity squared plus 1. And again, I like seeing this. Could you distribute that 3/4? Absolutely, and it would still produce the same graph. But this shows me the transformations so much nicer, shows me where we end up so much nicer, I think. So just so you're aware what I'm looking for, what really points out to me whether you've got it or not. Next, now we're supposed to graph the quadratic function, identify the form, its standard vertex or intercept form, find the vertex and the AOS or axis of symmetry, find the maximum or minimum, describe where the function's increasing and where it's decreasing. Lots of vocabulary here. You can use your calculator to graph if you want, but if we know how to graph using transformations, we just got done realizing how much faster that is. So this right here where we can see all the transformations, that's vertex form. And that's really nice because I can easily tell this shifts to the right 1 and down 4. My vertex is the point 1, negative 4. Okay, from there, I see it's 3 times as tall, so I can use my standard parabolic growth. There's a video on that if you wanted to check that out. As well, we could use that to plot some points and really get an accurate graph really quickly. So there's the graph of the function. Again, there's that glitchy spot in the smart board. I apologize for that. It's just kicking over by about an inch each time. That should be a smooth parabola. The maximum or minimum value, it's occurring at the vertex. So when they say value, they mean the output. The minimum value is a minimum of negative 4. The axis of symmetry, what vertical line splits that parabola perfectly in half? That's the line x equals 1, and it should match up perfectly with the x-coordinate of our vertex, so it does that. Domain for any parabola is all real numbers, or we could use the real numbers symbol if we'd like. The range, in this case, from bottom to top, I see that function outputting everything that is y greater than or equal to negative 4. Now, increasing and decreasing. Where is the graph rising to the right, and where is it falling to the right? So increasing, I notice that it's rising to the right over here, and it's falling to the right over here. So we describe that using the x values. It is increasing when x is greater than 1, because that is where I see the graph sloping upward. As soon as I get past the AOS, it's sloping upward, it's increasing. That means it's decreasing on the other side when x is less than 1. All right, now the point that is the vertex, that is a point where the graph is neither increasing nor decreasing, so we do not include that. Notice that those are just less than and greater than symbols. They don't have the or equals underneath. All right, but there you go. You can see we did that very quickly, and to have a calculator to back us up on this, man, we should have this made in the shade. Just remember that filling in all these blanks correctly, remembering that axis of symmetry, don't just put 1, it's x equals 1. For range, don't just put greater than or equal to negative 4. It's y that's greater than or equal to negative 4. Be sure that you're including everything in your answers as you fill those in. Here's another one. This parabola is in standard form. Okay, because everything's been foiled out. There's no transformations that are clearly evident. To find our vertex, we're going to have to go through the AOS. So I'm going to start by finding the AOS. And that is x equals the opposite of b. B is 16, so opposite of that, negative 16, over 2 times a, that's negative 4. If I simplify that, x equals positive 4 is my AOS. And we know that AOS has to pass through the vertex, so that's the x-coordinate of my vertex as well. I also know that for increasing and decreasing, that happens around the vertex. So all I need to do is fill in those inequality symbols, less than or greater than, once I get to that point. It's going to be x something 4 for both of those. I also know that the domain for any parabola is all real numbers, and the range, we'll figure that out in just a second. We need that vertex y value to figure that out. So we filled in an awful lot just doing negative b over 2a. So let's see, if I take f of 4, that will give me the y value, the output, that goes along with, you know, the 4 as an input that will complete my vertex. So negative 2 times 4 squared, negative 2 times 16, that's negative 32, plus 16 times 4, that's 64, plus 3. And we can use a calculator to find that value for sure, but I get 35. Yikes, way up there. Okay, so maybe I'll count by fives on this axis. So 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50. But and then my x-axis will count by ones. So just show that I'm changing the labels here. You will not have to do this on the test. The test, your graphs will fit as the grid is provided. This one's just really, really up there. Okay, so I've got the point 4 up at 35. It'll be right there. And I know it's opening downward, and it's twice as tall. So we would fill that in. You could use your calculator table to find some of these values as well. But let's just see here. If I go over 1, it would be down 2. Be about there. Over 2, it would be down 8. Down 8, about there. So it looks like it's stretched out, but that's just because my y-axis is scaled so weirdly. And again, that glitch in the smart board happening, I apologize for that. The nice thing is I know that I have a maximum because that parabola opens downward, and I could tell from a calculator or once I've drawn my graph here as well. The output that's a maximum is 35 at that vertex. That'll always be coming out of the vertex. And the range, I know now it's outputting all y values less than or equal to that 35 that we had for a maximum. Increasing and decreasing, well, my graph is sloping upward and then sloping downward. So it increases up to the vertex and then decreases coming out of it. So where is it increasing? When x is less than 4. That means off to the left of the vertex is where that graph is rising up to the peak. And then x greater than 4, it's then falling after it passes through that vertex. Very cool how this all comes together. It's really, really neat stuff. All right, so here we have a parabola that's given in vertex, or no, sorry, not vertex form, intercept form, and it's basically all factored for us. So this is really, really nice. The x-intercepts, right, those are something comma zero, something comma zero, and I'm just taking the solutions coming out of those factors, positive 3 and negative 7. We essentially switch the signs as we pull those values out. What would zero out those factors? And the vertex is just going to take those values and average them. So if I take negative 7 plus, sorry, this is to find my AOS, negative 7 plus 3 divided by 2, I get negative 2. So my vertex is the point negative 2 something. Let's plug in a negative 2 and see what we come up with. So I want g of negative 2. Found the x value. Let's find the output. Negative 2 minus 3 is negative 5. Negative 2 plus 7 is positive 5. 1/5 times 5 is 1. I get negative 5. And again, a calculator could help us, so there's no need to be worried if we don't have those quick algebra shortcuts memorized. Next, write the equation of the vertical parabola that has a vertex at 3, 4 and passes through the point 1, negative 8. Well, notice that we're given the vertex, so that means vertex form is going to be the key to solving this problem. So let's start off with that. And I know that the vertex is the point h, k, and this point that it passes through is some x, y combination. So as I look at my vertex form, the only thing I don't know is a. So let's plug in what we know. Y of negative 8 equals that unknown a times x of 1 minus h of 3 squared plus k of 4. And we'll solve that. Remember your order of operations here. Negative 2 squared is a positive 4. Subtract 4 from both sides. 4 times a, I'll call that 4a instead. Divide both sides by 4. Negative 3 equals a. Now my answer has to be the equation. So it's going to look an awful lot like this. I'm just going to have numbers filled in for a, h, and k. The equation is still going to be a y equals parabola, but now I know a is negative 3 times x minus h, my vertex, x minus 3 is that quantity squared, and then plus 4. And I'm sorry for that glitch in the smart board. It's happening right where I want that exponent to be. That's a second power. There we have it. That's pretty quick. It's nice that we don't have to take the time and graph and fill in all those blanks. Number 9, here we're taking a real world situation. Maximum and minimum values are very, very useful in the real world when we start analyzing functions over time, maximizing things like profits and minimizing things like costs. Stuff like that goes a long way. So we have a function that models the value of a share of stock in a company over the course of an 8-hour workday. Y gives the value of the stock, and X is the number of hours after 9 a.m. Letter A says, at what time is the value of the stock at a minimum? So realize, to find a minimum, we just need to know what's the vertex. Okay, and realize that my points are time, comma, value of the stock. So input X is time, output Y is the value. So since it's in standard form, I'm going to start by finding the AOS. All right, so if I do my X equals negative B over 2A, I get opposite of B is positive 40 over 2 times A is 10. I get 4. So X equals 4, that's hours after 9 a.m. That's an acceptable answer. I really like it if you would say 1 o'clock p.m. and do the math to kind of figure out what time of day. Because if somebody asks you, hey, what time does school get out? You don't say 3 hours after noon. You say 3:15 or 3 o'clock or something like that. You have a time answer. So this is the best answer right here. Okay, and then letter B says, what was the value of the stock at that time? So value is my output. I'm going to take that 4 and plug it in to the function. All right, 5 times 4 squared is 80. That stock was $7. And again, we can use a calculator to do all that arithmetic. The key thing is we know that we want the output of the function. We know what the input is, x equals 4. Plug it in. All right, and lastly, we have a regression problem. So I'm going to revisit how to enter in this data and come up with a regression equation with you real quickly. So I'm going to pull up my calculator here. And what we'll do is, after turning it on, we'll hit the stat key and edit our stats. For list one, we've got 0, 0.5. I'm typing in all my x values. Then I'll move over to list two with the y values, 150, 146, whoops, 134, 114, 86, and 50. I'm going to really quickly check, make sure each X is paired with a Y, and that I've typed in everything the right way. Not missing any decimal points, didn't mistype anything. Once that's all entered and good, I'm going to hit Stat yet again, go over to Calc. This is a quadratic regression, so we want to go to option 5. And you may have a calculator that says, like, gives you a menu, go down to Calculate. I'm just going to hit Enter, and here's what we get. The results of our quadratic regression. Okay, so I'm going to back out of that. Here are the results of that quadratic regression again. So what we need to do is write that function. In this case, it's y equals the a is negative 16 x squared plus 0x. There's no b term. And c is 150. And we can clean that up. If it's 0x, we don't need that term in the middle. So there's the first part, our regression equation that came right out of the calculator. Then it says to use that model to determine the height after 3 seconds. So I'm going to plug in 3 to that equation that I just came up with. And 16 times 9 is 90 and 54. That's negative 144. 6. I want to be sure I answer the question. Height is being measured in feet, so 6 feet. We've answered that question completely. All right. I apologize if I was moving kind of quickly through this. My point was just to be able to show you the steps moving through this review guide, get you ready in as quickly or as short amount of time as possible. And I hope this video has done that. I hope you've found use in it, and I wish you the best of luck as you study for this test.